विद द शॉक वेव। तो आर यू एबल टू सी दिस पीडीएफ कॉपी?
सर,
यस
विजिबल
यस। सो इट इज
सर।
अ मॉडर्न कंप्रेसिबल फ्लो बुक। सो ब्रीफली आई विल गो through this. So oblique shock wave definition says that it is a shock wave which forms in a supersonic flow when a supersonic flow turns into itself, means the flow direction turns into itself. Such kind of flow phenomena will happen whenever a supersonic flow strikes over a concave corner, right? The point of contact in concave corner, there one shock wave will originate. That wave is known as oblique shock wave. So flow properties, if we look at the oblique shock wave, usually that will be inclined. So the wave angle will be less than 90 degree in the case of oblique shock wave, and that wave angle may be positive or negative. That depends on the direction of the motion. So higher the wave angle, higher will be the strength of the oblique shock wave. So that you will come to know from the formulas. At present, I'm giving you just theory. Mathematically, we'll prove that the shock strength depends on the wave angle. That one formula is there. So if we look at the upstream flow properties, Mach number will be greater than one, because all shock wave will form only when your Mach number is greater than one. So a supersonic flow is approaching a concave corner here. And it turns into itself. So flow direction gets deflected with respect to the free stream direction. Free stream direction is horizontal. So corresponding to that, flow is getting deflected by an angle theta. That theta is flow deflection angle. So just behind the shock wave, if you look at, the Mach number will get decreased. Still, flow will not be subsonic in this case. Flow still be supersonic, but speed will be lesser than the upstream Mach number. So M2 will be less than M1, but still flow will be supersonic. And if you look at the pressure, static pressure will increase because flow is getting decreased, decelerated. So as per the Bernoulli's principle, we can say the static pressure will increase. So when static pressure is increasing, static temperature will also increase. Corresponding static density will also increase. So if we are talking about the total pressure here, we say P01 and P02. So in this case, your total pressure will decrease in the case of oblique shock wave. Total temperature also cannot be treated as constant because flow is not isentropic through the oblique shock wave. So this is the flow regime in the case of oblique shock wave. Opposite to that, there is another kind of shock wave that is known as expansion wave or expansion fence. So whenever a supersonic flow strikes over the convex corner, especially convex corner, expansion fence will form. So that means what? The flow is turning away from itself. So in this case, your flow, supersonic flow, will turn from it away from its flow direction by an angle that is called flow deflection angle. So as in this case, flow is getting expanded. When something is getting expanded, that means what is? Its speed will increase. Means flow speed will increase. So the upstream Mach number is M1 in this case. So M2 will be greater than M1 because flow is getting expanded. When speed is increasing, my static pressure or static temperature and density, all these three parameters will decrease. So P2 is less than P1 and T2 is less than T1 and rho 2 is less than rho 1 in the case of expansion fence. So these are the two kind of shock wave, and third kind of shock wave is normal shock wave. So normal shock wave is a wave just behind that shock wave. If flow is approaching to a normal shock wave, downstream of the normal shock wave, flow will always be a subsonic flow. So immediately after the shock wave, flow will decelerate to the subsonic zone. But in other cases, like in oblique shock wave and in expansion fan, flow will not decelerate to the subsonic flow regime. It will be still supersonic. That is the main difference between that. And then you can compare based on the wave angle. Wave angle in the case of normal shock wave will be 90 degree because flow will be approaching, or you can say the shock wave will be standing at 90 degree or perpendicular to the flow direction in the case of normal shock wave. But another kind of shock wave, wave angle will be less than 90 degree. So that is the phenomena. But in normal shock wave, if you look at the flow, can be considered as isentropic. Means we can say the total properties remains the same upstream and downstream of the normal shock wave. So that's why we used to say T01 is equal to T02. And usually we consider P01 is equal to P02 for the normal shock wave case. But in other rest of two cases, like in oblique shock wave and expansion fans, total pressure cannot be treated as constant. It will decrease based on the flow direction, based on the flow properties. The initial shock wave, but this I'm not going to cover. This is the Mach wave and Mach cone. Already we have discussed about this. This Mach wave and the Mach wave will form the moment your flow is getting accelerated from the rest. So the moment it is reaching nearby Mach number one, whenever your flow speed is reaching nearby 99.6 meter per second, this kind of waves will be forming over the surface. So strength of these waves are infinitesimally small, so they are not going to change any flow properties upstream or downstream of the flow, but they will be forming over the surface. These are having very weak strength, so these kind of waves are just Mach wave, or you can say pressure pulses. So for that, these usually will form the conical, this called Mach cone will form if my object is traveling at faster speed than the speed of the sound wave. In that case, all the disturbances will lie within this cone, and this will be forming some sort of cone. And from this cone, I will get one important relation for the Mach angle, which is given by sine mu is equal to AT by VT, and that is inversely proportional to the Mach number, local Mach number. The moment you know the local Mach number, you can find out the remaining parameters, because flow across the Mach wave will always be the asymptotic. So asymptotic relations can easily be applied to find out the remaining properties. This is regarding that. Then oblique shock relations, all the three fundamental equations can be applied. Continuity, momentum, and energy equations can be applied upstream and downstream of the oblique shock wave, and we can find out the important relation, that is nothing but theta beta m relation. That is given by tan theta is equal to 2 cot beta, and this bracket term m1 square sin square beta minus 1 divided by m1 square gamma plus cos 2 beta plus 2. So this is very, very important relation. So out of these this formula, any two parameters are known, third parameters can be the calculator. If I know the local Mach number and I know the shock wave angle, I can find out the flow deflection angle. Or usually flow deflection angle will be a fixed quantity that depends on the corner inclination. So theta will be known to you. So the moment you know the theta and upstream Mach number, you can find out the wave angle. The moment you know the wave angle, you can find out the remaining means shock strength. And from shock strength, you can find out the pressure ratio. The moment you know the pressure ratio, you can find out the temperature ratio. So all other pressure variations can be calculated. Another thing is that oblique shock wave flow across oblique shock wave can also be treated like normal shock wave if we are looking in the direction parallel to the downstream flow direction. So, or you can say when we are applying the continuity momentum equation across the oblique shock wave, that is perpendicular to the oblique shock wave, then oblique shock wave can also be treated as a normal shock wave. So, by using the normal shock wave formula, also we can find out the properties for the oblique shock wave. So this is the relationship between the Mach number across the oblique shock wave that is given by MN1, that is related to M1 sine beta. Similarly, MN2 can also be related as M2 sine beta minus theta. So if I know the upstream Mach number, I can find out the Mach number normal to the oblique shock wave as MN1. And with the help of MN1, using the normal shock wave relations, I can find out the M2 and remaining parameter, pressure ratio, temperature ratio can also be calculated. From this theta beta m relation, I can draw the property variation like shock wave angle here, beta versus theta. I will get this kind of curves, and this each curve, as we are moving towards right side, from left to right, my Mach number is increasing. The moment my Mach number is increasing, if for a particular Mach number, if I follow this curve, all right, as flow deflection angle is increasing, my wave angle is also increasing. Then a then a point will reach which will divide the flow region into two solutions, because this is just some sort of quadratic equation. If you solve this for any flow deflection angle, I will get two values of Mach numbers. One is subsonic, another is supersonic. So based on that, I will get two kind of strength of wave, that is shock strength, means a high strong shock wave and weak shock wave, depending on the theta value. So here one limit will reach. Above that, it will be a strong shock solution, that is beta is more, and downside of this is a weak solution where beta is less. So usually in most of the cases, we consider weak strength, that is beta value will lie always less than 70 degree, so most of the oblique shock wave case. So then if we look at this, so from theta beta m relation, there is a certain value of flow deflection angle up to which we will get a solution. And if we are crossing that maximum flow deflection angle, we will not have any solution for the attached shock wave. That means the moment our theta is becoming greater than theta max, as per that formula, my shock will not be attached over the surface, but it will detach and so it will be lying somewhere in the flow domain ahead of the object. So this is the case which is given here. This will happen where theta is greater than theta max. If my theta is less than theta max, in that case, my shock wave will be attached over the surface. So case will be something like this. The theta is less than theta max. So from this formula, if we calculate a theta max for a particular limiting case of Mach number, we will get a value of around 22.4 degrees. So beyond that, if you are crossing, in that case, detached shock wave will form. That means we will not have any solution for a straight oblique shock wave if my theta is greater than theta max. So this is a simple formulations regarding to the oblique shock wave. Then yes, this much is needed. From this point of view, if we go for expansion fans, that is called Prandtl-Meyer expansion waves, right? This will form on a convex corner. So situation will be something like this. So whenever flow is turning away from itself, it was coming like that, now turning away from itself. So this kind of waves will be forming. These are known as expansion fans. So every expansion fan will have certain angle, which is given by mu 1. This is a flow shock wave angle, or expansion fan angle given by mu. This mu are the angles, corresponding angles of the fans. So using the continuity and momentum equation across these fans, we can derive relationship for this Prandtl-Meyer function, which is given as mu. So mu is a Prandtl-Meyer function, is a function of Mach number. So we are relating Prandtl-Meyer function in terms of Mach number. So we'll get this relation. Gamma plus 1 upon gamma minus 1 tan inverse, this complete term minus tan inverse, this term. This is very, very important relation. So for a particular Mach number, we'll have a one value of Prandtl-Meyer function. So upstream Prandtl-Meyer function will be different than the downstream Mach number Prandtl-Meyer function. So if I want to find out the flow deflection angle at which your flow is getting deflected, I can find out, I can differentiate, or I can subtract the new one from new one and new two, I can get the theta value, that is flow deflection angle. So theta is given by the new at m2 minus new at m1. So this is the flow deflection angle. In some cases, when flow deflection angle is given and Mach number 1 is given, with the help of the Mach number 1 and theta, I can find out the Mach number 2 and corresponding Prandtl-Meyer function from this relation. All right, so all rest of the formulas are same, like Rankine-Hogonite relation will be applied for Prandtl-Meyer function, Prandtl-Meyer expansion fans, like T2 by T1 in terms of Mach number and T1 by T2 in terms of Mach number. Then this is the shock expansion theory. Basically, this is the expansion of you can say application of all three kind of shocks in thin airfoil particularly. So this is a case of diamond shape airfoil. So if we are going to find out the drag, we'll have to take the difference of pressure across the flow direction. So drag, when we are calculating drag, we have to take the difference between upstream, means this flow, the surface which are facing the flow, and surfaces from where flow is getting detached. So difference between these surface pressures will give us the drag. So if we look at this equation, which is written here, drag is two times of P2 L sine alpha. That means this is P2, and this is the epsilon is the half angle of this diamond shape vase. So if we are calculating, this is cos, this is the sine, right? And we need to equivalent the pressure this side, means along the flow direction, right? Drag always acts along the flow direction. So we need to consider these two pressures as positive, and P3 and this P4 pressure as negative. Difference of these four pressures will give us drag. So as P2 and here and here pressures are same because surface geometry is same. So that's why two times of P2 L sine alpha. So L sine alpha is this. L is given by this length. L sine alpha is this thickness, half thickness. So P2 L sine epsilon minus P3 L sine epsilon. So I can take this L sine epsilon as common. So I can write two times of P2 minus P3, and L epsilon is nothing but half of thickness. So T by 2 I can write. So this is the T by 2. So directly I can write drag is equal to P2 minus P3 times of T. So T is the thickness. So like that, I can derive expression for lift as well. So when we are finding out the lift, we have to consider these two surface, top surfaces and bottom surface pressure difference. So in this case, our chord length will come into the picture. So this complete chord length will come into the picture. So when you are writing the lift will be nothing but these two pressures minus these two pressure multiplied by the chord length. So these two very simple formulations can be derived on the thin airfoil using the shock expansion theory. So this much is the thing that we have to see the numerical problem. This one dimensional flow already we have covered. Area Mach number relation have been already discussed, and based on that we have said that for a particular kind of flow, if you want to get it accelerated, which kind of flow geometry we need to use. If we want to decelerate, then which kind of geometry is needed? That idea will get from the area Mach number relation, which is given here. dA by a is equal to m square minus 1 du by eu. Then finally, we have derived the expression for area ratio in terms of Mach number, which is here. And we have seen this variation as well, the Mach number variation with area ratio. And this is the flow through nozzle. This already got discussed, and we have seen some numerical problems based on that. So this much theory is enough for today. So I am directly going to the numerical problems that we are going to discuss today. So this is the problem that we will see. So problem is very simple. So it is written like, consider a supersonic flow with Mach number 2 at pressure 1 atmosphere, temperature is 288 Kelvin. This flow is deflected at a compression corner. So compression corner is nothing but a concave corner where flow will be deflecting into itself through 20 degrees. So flow deflection angle is given as 20 degree. Calculate the Mach number, temperature, that these are all static temperature, total pressure, total temperature behind the resulting oblique shock wave. So we need to find out the properties, all properties behind the oblique shock wave. Upstream Mach number and static pressure, the static temperatures are given, flow deflection angle is given. So as we are using the gas table, so we can go to the oblique shock wave table at corresponding Mach number and theta. Particularly these two things are needed, Mach number and theta. We can find out the shock wave angle beta and corresponding pressure ratio P2 by P1 and Mach 2, that is Mach number behind the oblique shock wave, can directly taken from the table. And as we know P1 and T1, so we can find out the P2 and T2 directly. So even T2 by T1 can also be taken from the table. No need to do that. That is the one way. Other way, if you are using the normal shock wave table, then you can proceed in this way. You can write MN1 is equal to M1 sine beta and MN2 is equal to M2 sine beta minus theta. So you'll have MN1 and MN2. Now you can use the normal shock wave table. So at MN1, you can read MN2 directly from the table. and corresponding P2Y P1 and T2Y T1 can be read from the tables. You can find out the temperature, final temperature, Mach number. So when you are calculating the M2, you will have Mn2 value. From Mn2 value, you can calculate the M2 by using this relation. All right. So then total pressure, I will use this relation, P02 by P2 is equal to this standard relation of isentropic, right? Because we are applying the isentropic flow upstream and downstream, but across the oblique shock wave, there will be no isentropic flow, but upstream and downstream flow can be treated like isentropic. So even I'm writing P02 by P2, instead of this, I can write P01 by P1 in terms of Mach number 1. As in this problem, it is been asked that we need to calculate P02 and T02, so I will have to apply the isentropic relation only downstream of the oblique shock wave. So I know these relations, I can directly find out the P02 and T02. So this kind of problem will come from the oblique shock wave. Very simple thing. Again, you consider second problem. Consider an oblique shock wave with an wave angle. Here, wave angle is given, and upstream Mach number is also given. Calculate theta. In earlier case, theta was given. Here, wave angle is given. Pressure and temperature ratio across the shock wave and M2 need to be calculated. This is almost similar to the first problem. So in the oblique shock chart or oblique shock wave table, you can directly go and add a given Mach number, and you have to look for the beta value in the table where it's lying. If directly 30 degrees is not given, then you have to do the interpolation. If interpolation problem is coming, then you can use the chart, which is theta beta m chart. So directly from the chart at given m1 and beta, I can get a theta, or by interpolation also I can get theta value. So the moment I know beta, and I can convert this oblique shock wave into the normal shock wave. So I can write Mn1. So corresponding Mn2 can be calculated from the normal shock wave table, or I can use this formula also. M2 square is equal to 2 by gamma less than M1 square. Using this formula, I can get Mn2. Then at this Mn1 and Mn2, I can find out T2 by T1 by using relation. So no need to mug up this relation as you are using guess table. So at Mn1, directly from the normal shock wave, you will get T2 by T1 and P2 by P1. So corresponding pressures and temperature can be calculated. Now consider this problem. This problem says, consider Mach 3 flow. It is desired to slow this flow to a subsonic speed. So keep in mind, we want to decelerate this flow to subsonic speed. So here, two methods have been proposed, considered two separate ways of achieving. First case, the flow is slowed by passing directly through normal shock wave. This is the first case. Second case, flow first passes through an oblique shock wave with 40 degree wave angle, then it passes through a normal shock wave. So in first case, there is only normal shock wave. Second case, a normal oblique shock wave followed by a normal shock wave. Calculate the ratio of final total pressure values for the two cases. So it is asking, you need to find out the final pressure, that is in the first case P02, in the second case third segment will also come, so P03. So we need to find out P03 by P01 and P02 by P01 for the two cases. Then finally, you have to comment on the significance of the results, right? In what way, why this variation is coming, a variation is coming, then that need to be you have to identify and comment. So let's suppose first case where only one normal shock wave is there and Mach 3 flow is approaching it, right? So only one normal shock wave. So at Mach 3, using the normal shock wave, I can read directly total pressure values, P02, P01 values, which is given here. All right. So only he's asking about pressure ratio, he's not asking about temperature ratio. So our task is over. So P02 is 0.3283 times of P01. That's the one task. Then we'll go put second segment where one oblique shock wave followed by the normal shock wave. So I can divide 1, 2, and 3 zones. So first I will solve for oblique shock wave, then I'll go for normal shock wave. So at Mach 3 by oblique shock wave chart, right? Or no need to use chart because flow deflection angle is given. All right. Or wave angle is given, so no problem. So at Mach 3 and wave angle 40 degree from the table, directly I can get theta. Right, then I can write MN1, and at MN1, using the normal shock wave table, I can get P02 value. So I will be reaching here P02 value, and corresponding M2 can also be calculated from the table. So M2 value also I will get. Now, from 2 to 3, by using the normal shock wave table at given M2, I can find out the P03 by P02, because P02 is known to us. So at M2 and theta normal shock wave table, P03 by P02 I will calculate. So P03 can be calculated in terms of P02. As we know, P02 in terms of P01, so P03 will be related to P01. All right. So what is the percentage loss in pressure happening, that can also be calculated. This is the first case. In first case, P01 minus P02 divided by P01, so total 67.17% total pressure loss is happening if flow is going through single shock wave, that is a normal shock wave. In second case, pressure loss is only 42.8% when it is passing through oblique shock wave than normal shock wave. So out of these two results, we have got an idea if flow is crossing single normal shock wave, pressure loss is more compared to it is passing through a series of oblique shock wave than normal shock wave. That means if you want to minimize the total pressure loss, then you can use the combination of shock waves to decelerate the flow from supersonic to subsonic. So minimize the losses of pressure from supersonic to subsonic, we can use combination of shock waves. That is the inference of these results. So this kind of problem can also be asked. This is the problem of shock expansion theory, right? Application of shock wave concept to the thin airfoil. So a flat plate is kept at 15 degree angle of attack to a supersonic stream at Mach number 2.4, which is shown in figure, which is here. Solve the flow field around the plate and determine the inclination of slip stream to the free stream direction using shock expansion theory. So just have a look on the diagram. This is a flat plate airfoil which is facing the flow at 15 degree, Mach number 2.4. So the moment the flow strikes over this corner, so here flow will be turning away from itself, and this side flow will be turning into itself, right? So here oblique shock wave will form. At this corner, your expansion fans will be generated. Then flow will be flowing over the surface. Finally, the moment is coming at the trailing edge. Here, flow will be turning into itself. So, oblique shock wave is formed. And this downside expansion fans have been formed. And this line, this dotted line, is the center line of the flat plate. And when the flow is leaving the trailing edge, it will be deflected by some angle. So, I will say this is the slip stream formed the moment flow is leaving the trailing edge. So this is the diagram. So now we'll solve one by one, starting from first from the top. Similarly for bottom, we have to solve it to find out the net deflection of the slip stream. So we'll solve from 1 to 2. This is a region 1 to 2. So at region 1, I know the Mach number 1, which is 2.4. I know the flow deflection angle, which is given as 15 degree angle. So by using these two things and using the isentropic relation or isentropic table, because the expansion fans, the cross expansion fans, the flow will be isentropic. So using isentropic table, I can find out the Prandtl-Meyer function nu one and corresponding flow deflection for the expansion fan mu one, P by P naught one and T by T naught one can be read from the table. So then I can go for nu two. So nu two is nothing but, as we say, this Mach number will be resulted of nu two minus nu one, or you can say flow deflection angle is equal to nu two minus nu one. So nu two will be calculated as nu two is equal to nu one minus theta. So nu one is 36.8, which is given here, right? And nu two need to be calculated. So nu two is equal to theta plus nu one. So theta is 15 degree and nu one is 36.8. We can add these two values to get the nu two. The moment I know the nu two from the table, I can get m2. and corresponding mu 2 and p 2 y p naught 2 and t 2 y t naught 2 can be read from the table. Then you come here at this point, right? This point nu 3 can also be further calculated, that is nu 2 plus theta, that is 66.8. Corresponding Mach number is 2.33. This is the case we have solved here. Now we'll go downside of it. So for downside, y first is the oblique shock wave, right? So y oblique shock wave at Mach number 1, 2. There is Mach number 1, 2.4, and theta is equal to 15 degree. I can get m2 dash, beta 2 dash. Then after that, this expansion fan. So I will get a nu 2 dash also at the m2. Then I will go for nu 3 by using the flow deflection angle. So it is here nu 2 dash is equal to 20.7 by table. Then nu 3 dash is equal to nu 2 dash plus theta, which is coming at 35.7. And corresponding Mach number is 2.36. If we compare the Mach number here, m3 dash and m3, the value which we are getting here, 2.33, here 2.36, very negligible difference in velocity is coming. That means what? Flow deflection, that is slip stream deflection with respect to free stream direction will be negligibly small, right? Because difference in velocity is very, very less. So I can say slip stream deflection is negligibly small. That's what he is asking. Determine the inclination of slip stream to the free stream direction, that is negligibly small, can be neglected. So it will be almost parallel to the free stream direction. So theta will be zero for the slip stream that need to be discussed out of this data. Next problem is this. Consider a Mach 2.5 airflow at a pressure of 1 atmosphere, which is desired to be slowed down to subsonic. Again, problem is we need to slow down this Mach 2.5 to subsonic with the minimum pressure loss, minimum total pressure loss. Use following options. Two options are given. No, three options are given. First option is simple normal shock waves. In this case, total pressure loss will be more, right? Then oblique shock wave with theta is equal to 20 degree followed by a normal shock wave. Here, total pressure loss will be lesser than the first case. Third case, an oblique shock wave with theta is equal to 20 followed by a second oblique shock wave, then followed by the normal shock wave. So in third case, total pressure loss will be minimum, right? Very, very less compared to other two cases. So already we have seen the earlier problem there we have got an idea how to solve that. So in a similar way, here also solution proceed. So part A, simple normal shock wave. So at Mach number given 2.5, using the normal shock wave table, I can find out the P02 and P01. So P02 and P01 percentage change in pressure can be calculated, which is coming around 50.1%. This much pressure loss is happening when flow is going through single normal shock wave. Second case, when oblique shock wave followed by the normal shock wave. In this case, we are solving, it is coming around 25.04%, right? So compared to first case and second case, total pressure loss is less. Third case, when two oblique shock waves are there at theta is equal to 20 degree, then theta is equal to 10 degree. So region 1 and 2, my flow deflection angle is only 20 degree. I know the Mach number 1. So m2 and p02 y p01 can be calculated. Now with the help of m2 and a theta, which is given here, 10 degree, right? Here the flow deflection is 10 degree. I can find out beta and m3, which is here. Now normal shock wave is there. So at m3, using the normal shock wave, I can find out the total pressure p04 here, right? So I need to rate p04 with p01. So here between 1 and 2, I will get p02 in terms of p01. Then between 2 and 3, I will get P03 in terms of P01. Then 3 and 4, I will get relations between P04 and P01. Then percentage loss in total pressure will be calculated. Here I am getting 17.16. So out of these three, right, minimum total pressure loss is happening in third case where two oblique shock wave and one normal shock wave is present. So this is the problem on moving shock wave, right? So a horizontal tube contains a stationary air at 1 atmosphere and 300 Kelvin. The left end of the tube is closed by a piston, right? So this is a piston which is closing the left end. At time t is equal to 0, it starts moving all of sudden abruptly at a speed of 100 meter per second to the right side. So all of sudden, if something is moving, it will be creating a pressure disturbance, or it will be creating a wave which will be traveling at a speed of sound, right? So CS is the speed of the wave by which it starts traveling the moment your piston started from the rest with a velocity. So it is asking find out the wave speed. What is the wave speed and the pressure on the face of the piston? So it's asking about pressure here. Downstream pressure P2 need to be calculated. So upstream pressure is 1 atmosphere and T1 is 300 Kelvin and V1 is equal to 0. So as wave is moving here, I need to make this wave stationary. So I need to apply a velocity equal to CS from the right to left. So the problem will become something like this. So this is a standing shock wave. I have applied CS. So difference in velocity here in this joint 2 will be CS minus 100, that is VP. So VP is lower, piston speed is lower than the speed of the wave. So CS minus 100 is here. Now I apply the continuity equation between 1 and 2. So this is my upstream, this is my downstream. So I apply the continuity equation. So from continuity equation, I can get rho 2 by rho 1. That is nothing but velocity at 1 and velocity at 2. So velocity at 1 is only CS, and velocity at 2 is CS minus 100. So I will substitute here. And rho 2 by rho 1 is nothing but m star square. So m star is critical Mach number. So I know the critical Mach number relation in terms of m1, that is gamma plus 1 m1 square divided by 2 plus gamma minus 1 m1 square. So by using this, all right, an upstream Mach number is also given. I can find out the CS, that is the speed of the wave. That has been asked. So I will get one quadratic kind of equation and finally I get the CS value. This is the speed of the shock wave, and corresponding Mach number can also be calculated. That is 1.19. So that's what these two things need to be asked. And pressure, so pressure ratio at Mach number 1, as it is a normal shock wave. So using the normal shock wave table at Mach number 1, I will get P2 by P1. So P2 will also be calculated. So these two things need to be calculated. Thing is very simple. If this medium is moving, I need to make it stationary by applying equal velocity from the second side. So my now wave will be appearing like a standing wave, and my problem is stationary. Now I can apply the continuity, momentum, and energy equation. So this is almost last problem. This is again shock expansion theory problem. A two-dimensional wave, as shown in figure, moves with a atmospheric in atmosphere at sea level. So sea level conditions will be applied at a zero angle of attack. So theta is equal to 0 with Mach number 3. Calculate the coefficient of lift and coefficient of drag using shock expansion theory. So this is the wedge. So it's a symmetrical wedge, right? 5 degree half wedge angle. So this is the flow geometry. If you look at the flow geometry, it will be something like this. So in flow geometry, at the starting, the moment your flow is coming into contact at this corner, oblique shock wave is forming. Then at the top of this vortex, expansion fan is forming. Then finally, the flow when it is leaving the trailing edge, there also oblique shock wave is forming. So this is the critical phenomena or flow field around this wave. So now you can solve it using the shock wave relation, or you can use the table to start with this problem. So let we apply the concept between 1 and 2. So this is the oblique shock wave. Downside, if you look at this is a pressure variation. So across the oblique shock wave, my pressure will decrease. So between A and B or 1 and 2, pressure is going like that, it's decreasing. Then expansion fan, again, further pressure will decrease because velocity is increasing, right? And finally, we come here. Oblique shock wave, it will build up, right? So here in oblique shock wave, pressure is increasing basically from atmosphere, and the initial value is this. Then the moment is striking the oblique shock wave, my pressure is increasing. Now remains constant between 1 and 2, between here 2, then further it decelerate. Here flow is getting accelerated, so pressure is decreasing, then again build up. So between region 1 and 2, you look at this zone 1 and 2 is oblique shock wave. So I can apply the oblique shock wave relation, or I can use the standard table to solve this problem. So at Mach number 3, theta is equal to 5 degree by oblique shock wave, I can get M2, P2 by P1, and beta can be taken from the table itself. So P2 can be calculated, right? Then using the isentropic relations, isentropic table at M1 itself, I can get total temperature and total pressure, right? Then at M2, when we reaching here, then expansion fan. So between 2 and 3 isentropic tables can be used. So at M2, 2.75, I can use the isentropic table to get P2 by P02, T2 by T02. So T2 and P02 can be calculated. Then region here 2 and 3 at M2 is equal to 2.75. I can get the Prandtl Mayer function nu 2, which is given here. Flow deflection angle is given at 10 degree at this Mach number, which can directly be taken from the table. So nu 3 is equal to flow deflection angle plus nu 2. So nu 3 corresponding M3 can be calculated. So at this M3 from the same table, I can get P3 and T3. So now I know P1, I know P2, I know P3. Here P2, P3 is known and P1 is already known. At bottom, there will be only P1. So P1 already given, the standard sea level condition. So now I can apply the lift equation. So lift is a P1 into chord length. So when you are calculating lift, we need to take this pressure difference across the chord length. So chord length is given as 1 meter. All right. So lift is equal to P1 into C into 1. P2 cos 5 degree, CY2 by cos 5 degree minus P3 cos 5 degree. CY2 cos 5 degree. What is this CY2 cos 5 degree? Basically, this surface we need to consider. This surface, horizontal component, this component we need to consider, and vertical component of pressure need to be considered. This is a P2 cos 5 degree, which is like this, and this component of this side will be cos. We have to apply here also. Cos we need to apply. So which is written here, CY2 cos 5. We know P1, P2 and P3 and chord length is 1. So directly we can get the lift value. So lift value from there, CL can be calculated. Lift by half rho V square into C. C is 1. So anyway, that will cancel out. I got the CL value. Corresponding drag equation can also be written. When we are writing for drag, we need to take the difference of pressure in this flow direction. So I need this thickness. So I need to express this surface length in terms of thickness. All right. So sine components will come into the picture. So I can write P2 sine 5 degree, CY2 cos 5 degree, and P3 sine 5 degree, CY2 y cos 5 degree. By applying P2 and P3 values here and chord length 1, I can get drag and corresponding CD will be calculated. So here I am stopping discussion today. Now I will give you some time for question answer if you're having, or else I will show you some more problems. First I welcome your questions. Yes.
How will be the questions asked? Is it a direct derivation or?
It will be the part of derivation basically. It will not be a direct derivation. So no question will be asked like drive an expression for the pressure variation across the oblique shock wave. Or there will be no direct derivation like show the Mach number variation across the normal shock wave. Instead of asking like that, in between, some modifications may be asked. You need to express, let's suppose I will frame a question like express the downstream mark number in terms of critical mark number in the flow, or chances are there express the downstream mark number in terms of upstream pressure in the flow. That kind of questions will be asked from the derivation part. Mostly 90% chances are there numerical.